Sally Dows. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 3. Chapter 3. In spite of the awkward termination of his visit, or perhaps because of it, Cortland called again at the plantation within the week. But this time he was accompanied by Drummond, and was received by Miss Miranda Dows, a tall, aquiline-nosed spinster of 50, whose old-time politeness had become slightly affected, and whose old beliefs had given way to a half-cynical acceptance of new facts. Mr. Drummond, delighted with the farm and its management, was no less fascinated by Miss Sally, while Cortland was now discreet enough to divide his attentions between her and her aunt, with the result that he was far from participating in Champney's conviction of Miss Miranda's unimportance. To the freedman she still represented the old implacable taskmistress, and it was evident that they superstitiously believed that she still retained a vague power of overriding the 14th Amendment at her pleasure, and was only to be restrained by the mediation of the good-humored and sensible Miss Sally. Cortland was quick to see the value of this influence in the transition state of the freedman, and pointed it out to his principal. Drummond's previous doubts and skepticism, already weakened by Miss Sally's fascinations, vanished entirely at this prospect of beneficially utilizing these lingering evils of slavery. He was convinced, he was even enthusiastic. The foreign investors were meant to be bought out, the estate improved and enlarged by the company, and the fair owners retained in the management and control. Like most prejudiced men, Drummond's conversion was sudden and extreme, and, being a practical man, was at once acted upon. At a second and third interview the preliminaries were arranged, and in 3 weeks from Cortland's first visit, the Dows plantation and part of Major Reed's were merged in the Drummond syndicate, and placed beyond financial uncertainty. Cortland remained to represent the company as superintendent at Redlands, and with the transfer of the English investments Champney retired, as he had suggested, to a smaller venture of his own, on a plantation a few miles distant which the company had been unable to secure. During this interval Cortland had frequent interviews with Miss Sally, and easy and unrestrained access to her presence. He had never again erred on the side of romance or emotion, he had never again referred to the infelix's letter and photograph, and, without being obliged to confine himself strictly to business affairs, he had maintained an even, quiet, neighborly intercourse with her. Much of this was the result of his own self-control and soldierly training, and gave little indication of the deeper feeling that he was conscious lay beneath it. At times he caught the young girl's eyes fixed upon him with a mischievous curiosity. A strange thrill went through him. There are few situations so subtle and dangerous as the accidental confidences and understandings of two young people of opposite sex, even though the question of any sentimental inclination be still in abeyance. Cortland knew that Miss Sally remembered the too serious attitude he had taken towards her past. She might laugh at it, and even resent it, but she knew it, remembered it, knew that he did, and this precious knowledge was confined to themselves. It was in their minds when there was a pause in their more practical and conventional conversation, and was even revealed in the excessive care which Miss Sally later took to avert at the right moment her mischievously smiling eyes. Once she went farther. Cortland had just finished explaining to her a plan for substituting small farm buildings for the usual half-cultivated garden patches dear to the Negro field hand, and had laid down the drawings on the table in the office, when the young lady, leaning against it with her hands behind her, fixed her bright gray eyes on his serious face. "I vow and protest, Colonel," she said, dropping into one of the quaint survivals of an old-time phraseology peculiar to her people, "I never allowed yo could just give yourself up to business, soul and body, as yo do, when I first met yo that day." "Why, what did you think me?" he asked quickly. Miss Sally, who had a southern aptitude for gesture, took one little hand from behind her, twirled it above her head with a pretty air of disposing of some airy nothing in a presumably masculine fashion, and said, "Oh, that. I am afraid I did not impress you then as a very practical man," he said, with a faint color. "I thought you roosted rather high, Colonel, to pick up many worms in the morning. But," she added with a dazzling smile, "I reckon from what yo said about the photograph, Yo thought I wasn't exactly what Yo believed I ought to be, either. He would have liked to tell her then and there that he would have been content if those bright, beautiful eyes had never kindled with anything but love or womanly aspiration, that soft, lazy, caressing voice had never been lifted beyond the fireside or domestic circle, that the sunny, tendriled hair and pink ears had never inclined to anything but whispered admiration, and that the graceful, lithe, erect figure, so independent and self-contained, had been satisfied to lean only upon his arm for support. He was conscious that this had been in his mind when he first saw her. He was equally conscious that she was more bewilderingly fascinating to him in her present inaccessible intelligence and practicality. "I confess," he said, looking into her eyes with a vague smile, "I did not expect you would be so forgetful of someone who had evidently cared for you." Meaning Mr. Chet Brooks, or Mr. Joyce Masterton, or both. "That's like most yo men, Conal. Yo reckon because a girl pleases yo she ought to be grateful all her life and yo ours, too. Yo think different now. But yo needn't act up to it quite so much." She made a little deprecating gesture with her disengaged hand as if to ward off any retaliating gallantry. "I ain't speaking for myself, Conal. Yo and me are good enough friends. But the girls round here think yo re a trifle too much taken up with rice and racial expletives. And looking at it even in yo our light, Conal, it ain't business. Yo want to keep straight with Major Reed, so it would be just as well to square the Major's woman folks. Tavy and Gussie Reed ain't exactly poisonous, Conal, and yo might see one or the other home from church next Sunday. The Sunday after that, just to show yo ain't particular, and that yo go in for being a regular beau, yo might walk home with me. Don't be frightened, I've got a better gown than this. It's a new one, just come home from Louisville, and I'll wear it for the occasion." He did not dare to say that the quaint frock she was then wearing, a plain checked household gingham used for children's pinafores, with its ribbons of the same pattern, gathered in bows at the smart apron pockets, had become a part of her beauty, for he was already hopelessly conscious that she was lovely in anything, and he might be impelled to say so. He thanked her gravely and earnestly, but without gallantry or effusion, and had the satisfaction of seeing the mischief in her eyes increase in proportion to his seriousness, and heard her say with affected concern, "Bear up, Conal. Don't let it worry yo till the time comes," and took his leave. On the following Sunday he was present at the Redlands Episcopal Church, and after the service stood with outward composure but some inward chafing among the gallant youth who, after the local fashion, had ranged themselves outside the doors of the building. He was somewhat surprised to find Mr. Champney, evidently as much out of place as himself, but less self-contained, waiting in the crowd of expectant cavaliers. Although convinced that the young Englishman had come only to see Miss Sally, he was glad to share his awkward isolation with another stranger, and greeted him pleasantly. The Dows pew, being nearer to the entrance than the Reeds, gave up its occupants first. Colonel Cortland lifted his hat to Miss Miranda and her niece at the same moment that Champney moved forward and ranged himself beside them. Miss Sally, catching Cortland's eye, showed the whites of her own in a backward glance of mischievous significance to indicate the following Reeds. When they approached, Cortland joined them, and finding himself beside Miss Octavia entered into conversation. Apparently the suppressed passion and sardonic melancholy of that dark-eyed young lady spurred him to a lighter, gayer humor even in proportion as Miss Sally's good-natured levity and sunny practicality always made him serious. They presently fell to the rear with other couples, and were soon quite alone. A little haughty, but tall and erect in her well-preserved black grenadine dress, which gave her the appearance of a youthful but implacable widow, Miss Reed declared she had not seen the Conal for a coon's age, and certainly had not expected to have the honor of his company as long as there were racial expletives to be elevated or painted to look like white men. She hoped that he and Pa and Sally Dowes were happy. They hadn't yet got so far as to put up a racial expletive preacher in the place of Mr. Sims, their rector, but she understood that there was some talk of running Hannibal Johnson, Miss Dowes' coachman, for county judge next year. No. She had not heard that the colonel himself had thought of running for the office. He might laugh at her as much as he liked. He seemed to be in better spirits than when she first saw him, only she would like to know if it was no THN style to laugh coming home from church? Of course if it was, she would have to adopt it with the 14th Amendment. But, just now, she noticed the folks were staring at them, and Miss Sally Dowse had turned round to look. Nevertheless, Miss Octavia's sallow cheek nearest the colonel the sunny side had taken a faint brunette's flush, and the corners of her proud mouth were slightly lifted. But, candidly, Miss Reed, don't you think that you would prefer to have old Hannibal, whom you know, as county judge, than a stranger and a northern man like me? Miss Reed's dark eyes glanced sideways at the handsome face and elegant figure beside her. Something like a saucy smile struggled to her thin lips. There mightn't be much to choose, Colonel. I admit it. We should both acknowledge our mistress, and be like wax in her hands. You ought to make that pooty speech to Sally Dowse, she's generally mistress around here. But, she added, suddenly fixing her eyes on him, how does it happen that you ain't walking with her instead of that Englishman? You know that it's as plain as day that he took that land over there just to be near her, when he was no longer agent. But Cortland was always master of himself and quite at ease regarding Miss Sally when not in that lady's presence. You forget, he said smilingly, that I'm still a stranger and knew little of the local gossip, and if I did know it, I am afraid we didn't bargain to buy up with the land Mr. Champney's personal interest in the landlady. You d have had your hands full, for I reckon she's pooty heavily mortgaged in that fashion, already, returned Miss Reed with mere badinage than spitefulness in the suggestion. And Mr. Champney was run pooty close by a French cousin of hers when he was here. You haven't got any French books to lend me, Conal, have you? Pa says you read a heap of French, and I find it mighty hard to keep up my practice since I left the convent at St. Louis, for Pa don't knew what sort of books to order, and I reckon he makes awful mistakes sometimes. The conversation here turning upon polite literature, it appeared that Miss Octavia's French reading, through a shy, proud innocence and an imperfect knowledge of the wicked subtleties of the language, was somewhat broad and unconventional for a young lady. Cortland promised to send her some books, and even ventured to suggest some American and English novels not intensely no-THN nor metaphysical according to the accepted Southern beliefs. A new respect and pitying interest in this sullen, solitary girl, cramped by tradition, and bruised rather than enlightened by sad experiences, came over him. He found himself talking quite confidentially to the lifted head, arched eyebrows, and aquiline nose beside him, and even thinking what a handsome high-bred brother she might have been to someone. When they had reached the house, in compliance with the familiar custom, he sat down on one of the lower steps of the veranda, while she, shaking out her skirt, took a seat a step or two above him. This enabled him, after the languid local fashion, to lean on his elbow and gaze up into the eyes of the young lady, while she with equal languor looked down upon him. But in the present instance Miss Reed leaned forward suddenly, and darting a sharp quick glance into his very consciousness said, "And yo mean to say, Conal, there's nothing between yo and Sally Dowse." Cortland neither flushed, trembled, grew confused, nor prevaricated. "We are good friends, I think," he replied quietly, without evasion or hesitation. Miss Reed looked at him thoughtfully, "I reckon that is so and no more. And that's why you've been so lucky in everything," she said slowly. "I don't think I quite understand," returned Cortland, smiling. "Is this a paradox or a consolation?" "It's the truth," said Miss Reed gravely. "Those who try to be anything more to Sally Dowse lose their luck. That is, are rejected by her." "Is she really so relentless?" continued Cortland gaily. "I mean that they lose their luck in everything. Something is sure to happen. And she can't help it either. Is this a sibylline warning, Miss Reed?" "No. It's racial expletive superstition. It came from Mammy Judy, Sally's old nurse. It's part of their regular hoodoo. She bewitched Miss Sally when she was a baby, so that everybody is bound to her as long as they care for her, and she isn't bound to them in any way. All their luck goes to her as soon as the spell is on them," she added darkly. "I think I know the rest," returned Cortland with still greater solemnity. "You gather the buds of the witch hazel in April when the moon is full. You then pluck three hairs from the young lady's right eyebrow when she isn't looking. Yo can laugh, Conal, for yo re lucky because yo re free. I'm not so sure of that," he said gallantly, "for I ought to be riding at this moment over to the infirmary to visit my Sunday sick. If being made to pleasantly forget one's time and duty is a sign of witchcraft, I am afraid Mammy Judy's enchantments were not confined to only one southern young lady." The sound of quick footsteps on the gravel path caused them both to look up. A surly-looking young fellow, ostentatiously booted and spurred, and carrying a heavy rawhide riding whip in his swinging hand, was approaching them. Deliberately, yet with uneasy self-consciousness, ignoring the presence of Cortland, he nodded abruptly to Miss Reed, ascended the steps, brushed past them both without pausing, and entered the house. "Is that your manners, Mr. Tom?" called the young lady after him, a slight flush rising to her sallow cheek. The young man muttered something from the hall which Cortland did not catch. "It's cousin Tom Higby," she explained half disdainfully. "He's had some ugliness with his horse, I reckon, but Pa ought to teach him how to behave. And I don't think he likes no THN men," she added gravely. Cortland, who had kept his temper with his full understanding of the intruder's meaning, smiled as he took Miss Reed's hand in parting. "That's quite enough explanation, and I don't know why it shouldn't be even an apology." Yet the incident left little impression on him as he strolled back to Redlands. It was not the first time he had tasted the dregs of former sectional hatred in incivility and discourtesy, but as it seldom came from his old personal antagonists the soldiers and was confined to the callow youth, previous noncombatants, and politicians, he could afford to overlook it. He did not see Miss Sally during the following week. Chapter 4. On the next Sunday he was early at church. But he had perhaps accented the occasion by driving there in a light buggy behind a fast thoroughbred, possibly selected more to the taste of a smart cavalry officer than an agricultural superintendent. He was already in a side pew, his eyes dreamily fixed on the prayer book ledge before him, when there was a rustle at the church door, and a thrill of curiosity and admiration passed over the expectant congregation. It was the entrance of the Dows party, Miss Sally well to the fore. She was in her new clothes, the latest fashion in Louisville, the latest but two in Paris and New York. It was over 20 years ago. I shall not imperil the effect of that lovely vision by recalling to the eye of today a fashion of yesterday. Enough, that it enabled her to set her sweet face and vapory golden hair in a horseshoe frame of delicate flowers, and to lift her oval chin out of a bewildering mist of tulle. Nor did a certain light polonaise conceal the outlines of her charming figure. Even those who were constrained to whisper to each other that Miss Sally must be now going on 25, did so because she still carried the slender graces of 17. The organ swelled as if to welcome her, as she took her seat. A ray of sunlight, that would have been cruel and searching to any other complexion, drifted across the faint pink of her cheeks, and nestling in her nebulous hair became itself transfigured. A few stained glass virtues on the windows did not come out of this effulgence as triumphantly, and it was small wonder that the devotional eyes of the worshippers wandered from them to the face of Sally Dows. When the service was over, as the congregation filed slowly into the aisle, Cortland slipped mutely behind her. As she reached the porch he said in an undertone, "I brought my horse and buggy. I thought you might possibly allow me to drive," but he was stopped by a distressful knitting of her golden brows. "No," she said quickly, but firmly, "you must not, it won't do." As Cortland hesitated in momentary perplexity, she smiled sweetly, "We'll walk round by the cemetery, if you like, it will take about as long as a drive." Cortland vanished, gave hurried instructions and a dollar to a lounging negro, and rejoined Miss Sally as the delighted and proud freedman drove out of the gate. Miss Sally heaved a slight sigh as the gallant equipage passed. It was a mighty pooty turnout, Conal, and I'd have just admired to go, but it would have been rather hard on the other folks. There's the Reeds and Maxwells and Robertsons that are too poor to keep blood horses, and too proud to ride behind anything else. It wouldn't be the right thing for us to go whirling by, scattering our dust over them. There was something so subtly pleasant in this implied partnership of responsibility, that Cortland forgot the abrupt refusal and thought only of the tact that prompted it. Nevertheless, here a spell seemed to fall upon his usually ready speech. Now that they were together for the first time in a distinctly social fashion, he found himself vacantly, meaninglessly silent, content to walk beside this charming, summery presence, brushed by its delicate draperies, and inhaling its freshness. Presently it spoke. It would take more than 1,000 feet of lumber to patch up the cow's heads beyond the Mosley pasture, and an entirely new building with an improved dairy would require only about 2,000 more. All the old material would come in good for fencing, and could be used with the new post and rails. Don't you think it would be better to have an out-and-out new building? Yes, certainly, returned Cortland a little confusedly. He had not calculated upon this practical conversation, and was the more disconcerted as they were passing some of the other couples, who had purposely lingered to overhear them. And, continued the young girl brightly, the freight question is getting to be a pretty serious one. Aunt Miranda holds some shares in the Briggsville branch line, and thinks something could be done with the directors for a new tariff of charges if she put a pressure on them. Tyler says that there was some talk of their reducing it 1/16 per cent before we move this year's crop. Cortland glanced quickly at his companion's face. It was grave, but there was the faintest wrinkling of the corner of the eyelid nearest him. Had we not better leave these serious questions until tomorrow, he said, smiling. Miss Sally opened her eyes demurely. Why, yo seemed so quiet, I reckoned yo must be full of business this morning, but if yo prefer company talk, we'll change the subject. They say that yo and Miss Reed didn't have much trouble to find one last Sunday. She don't usually talk much, but she keeps up a power of thinking. I should reckon, she added, suddenly eyeing him critically, that yo and she might have a heap o' things to say to each other. She's a good deal in yo fashion, Conal, she don't forget, but more slowly I don't know that that's altogether the best thing for yo. Cortland lifted his eyes with affected consternation. If this is in the light of another mysterious warning, Miss Dowse, I warn you that my intellect is already tottering with them. Last Sunday Miss Reed thrilled me for an hour with superstition and Cassandra-like prophecy. Don't things ever happen accidentally here, and without warning? I mean, returned the young lady with her usual practical directness, that Tave Reed remembers a good many horrid things about the Wa that she ought to forget, but don't. But, she continued, looking at him curiously, she allows she was mighty cut up by her cousin's manner to yo. I am afraid that Miss Reed was more annoyed than I was, said Cortland. I should be very sorry if she attached any importance to it, he added earnestly. And yo don't, continued Miss Sally. No. Why should I? She noticed, however, that he had slightly drawn himself up a little more erect, and she smiled as he continued, I dare say I should feel as he does if I were in his place. But yo wouldn't do anything underhanded, she said quietly. As he glanced at her quickly she added dryly, don't trust too much to people always acting in yo fashion, Conal. And don't think too much nor too little of what yo hear here. Yo re just the kind of man to make a good many silly enemies, and as many foolish friends. And I don't know which will give yo the most trouble. Only don't yo underrate either, or hold yo head so high, yo don't see what's crawling around yo. That's why, in a copperhead swamp, a horse is bitten oftener than a hog. She smiled, yet with knitted brows and such a pretty affectation of concern for her companion that he suddenly took heart. I wish I had one friend I could call my own, he said boldly, looking straight into her eyes. I'd care little for other friends, and fear no enemies. You're right, Conal, she said, ostentatiously slanting her parasol in a marvelous simulation of hiding a purely imaginative blush on a cheek that was perfectly infantine in its unchanged pink, company talk is much puttier than what we've been saying. And meaning me, for I reckon yo wouldn't say that of any other girl but the one yo re-walking with. What's the matter with me? He could not help smiling, though he hesitated. Nothing, but others have been disappointed. And that bothers yo. I mean, I have as yet had no right to put your feelings to any test, while poor Chet had, yo were going to say. Well, here we are at the cemetery. I reckoned yo were bound to get back to the dead again before we'd gone far, and that's why I thought we might take the cemetery on our way. It may put me in a more proper frame of mind to please yo. As he raised his eyes, he could not repress a slight start. He had not noticed before that they had passed through a small gateway on diverging from the road, and was quite unprepared to find himself on the edge of a gentle slope leading to a beautiful valley, and before him a long vista of tombs, white headstones and low crosses, edged by drooping cypress and trailing feathery vines. Some vines had fallen and been caught in long loops from bough to bough, like funeral garlands, and here and there the tops of isolated palmettos lifted a cluster of hearse-like plumes. Yet in spite of this dominance of somber but graceful shadow, the drooping delicacy of dark tasseled foliage and leafy fringes, and the waving morning veils of gray, translucent moss, a glorious vivifying southern sun smiled and glittered everywhere as through tears. The balm of bay, southernwood, pine, and syringa breathed through the long alleys, the stimulating scent of roses moved with every zephyr, and the closer odors of jessamine, honeysuckle, and orange flowers hung heavily in the hollows. It seemed to Cortland like the morning of beautiful and youthful widowhood, seductive even in its dissembling trappings, provocative in the contrast of its own still strong virility. Everywhere the grass grew thick and luxuriant, the quick earth was teeming with the germination of the dead below. They moved slowly along side by side, speaking only of the beauty of the spot and the glory of that summer day, which seemed to have completed its perfection here. Perhaps from the heat, the overpowering perfume, or some unsuspected sentiment, the young lady became presently as silent and preoccupied as her companion. She began to linger and loiter behind, hovering like a butterfly over some flowering shrub or clustered sheaf of lilies, until, encountered suddenly in her floating draperies, she might have been taken for a somewhat early and far too becoming ghost. It seemed to him, also, that her bright eyes were slightly shadowed by a gentle thoughtfulness. He moved close to her side with an irresistible impulse of tenderness, but she turned suddenly, and saying, "Come," moved at a quicker pace down a narrow side path. Cortland followed. He had not gone far before he noticed that the graves seemed to fall into regular lines, the emblems became cheaper and more common. Wooden head and footstones of one monotonous pattern took the place of carved freestone or marble, and he knew that they had reached that part of the cemetery reserved for those who had fallen in the war. The long lines drawn with military precision stretched through the little valley, and again up the opposite hill in an odd semblance of hollow squares, ranks, and columns. A vague recollection of the fateful slope of Snake River came over him. It was intensified as Miss Sally, who was still preceding him, suddenly stopped before an isolated mound bearing a broken marble shaft and a pedestal with the inscription, "Chester Brooks." A few withered garlands and immortelles were lying at its base, but encircling the broken shaft was a perfectly fresh, unfaded wreath. "You never told me he was buried here," said Cortland quickly, half shocked at the unexpected revelation. "Was he from this state?" "No, but his regiment was," said Miss Sally, eyeing the wreath critically. "And this wreath, is it from you?" continued Cortland gently. "Yes, I thought yo'd like to see something fresh and pooty, instead of those stale ones." "And were they also from you?" he asked even more gently. "Dear no. They were left over from last anniversary day by some of the veterans. That's the only one I put there, that is, I got Mr. Champney to leave it here on his way to his house. He lives just yonder, yo know." It was impossible to resist this invincible naivete. Cortland bit his lip as the vision arose before him of the still more naive English admirer bringing hither, At Miss Sally's bidding, the tribute which she wished to place on the grave of an old lover to please a third man. Meantime, she had put her two little hands behind her back in the simulated attitude of a good girl, and was saying half smilingly, and he even thought half wistfully, "Are you satisfied?"
"Perfectly."
"Then let's go away. It's mighty hot here." They turned away, and descending the slope again re-entered the thicker shade of the main avenue. Here they seemed to have left the sterner aspect of death. They walked slowly, the air was heavy with the hot incense of flowers, the road sinking a little left a grassy bank on one side. Here Miss Sally halted and listlessly seated herself, motioning Cortland to do the same. He obeyed eagerly. The incident of the wreath had troubled him, albeit with contending sensations. She had given it to please him, why should he question the manner, or torment himself with any retrospective thought? He would have given worlds to have been able to accept it lightly or gallantly with any other girl he could, but he knew he was trembling on the verge of a passionate declaration, the magnitude of the stake was too great to be imperiled by a levity of which she was more a mistress than himself, and he knew that his sentiment had failed to impress her. His pride kept him from appealing to her strangely practical nature, although he had recognized and accepted it, and had even begun to believe it an essential part of the strong fascination she had over him. But being neither a coward nor a weak, hesitating idealist, when he deliberately took his seat beside her he as deliberately made up his mind to accept his fate, whatever it might be, then and there. Perhaps there was something of this in his face. "I thought you were looking a little white, Conal," she said quietly, "and I reckoned we might sit down a spell, and then take it slowly home. You ain't accustomed to the sothn sun, and the air in the hollow was swampy." As he made a slight gesture of denial, she went on with a pretty sisterly superiority, "That's the way of you nothn men. You think you can do everything just as if you were reared to it, and you never make allowance for different climates, different blood, and different customs. That's where you slip up." But he was already leaning towards her with his dark earnest eyes fixed upon her in a way she could no longer mistake. "At the risk of slipping up again, Miss Dows," he said gently, dropping into her dialect with utterly unconscious flattery, "I am going to ask you to teach me everything you wish, to be all that you demand, which would be far better. You have said we were good friends, I want you to let me hope to be more. I want you to overlook my deficiencies and the differences of my race and let me meet you on the only level where I can claim to be the equal of your own people, that of loving you. Give me only the same chance you gave the other poor fellow who sleeps yonder, the same chance you gave the luckier man who carried the wreath for you to put upon his grave." She had listened with delicately knitted brows, the faintest touch of color, and a half-laughing, half-superior disapprobation. When he had finished, she uttered a plaintive little sigh. "You oughtn't to have said that, Conal, but you and me are too good friends to let even that stand between us. And to prove it to you I'm going to forget it right away, and so are you." "But I cannot," he said quickly, "if I could I should be unworthy of even your friendship. If you must reject it, do not make me feel the shame of thinking you believe me capable of wanton trifling. I know that this avowal is abrupt to you, but it is not to me. You have known me only for 3 months, but these 3 months have been to me the realization of 3 years' dreaming." As she remained looking at him with bright, curious eyes, but still shaking her fair head distressedly, he moved nearer and caught her hand in the little pale lilac thread glove that was, nevertheless, too wide for her small fingers, and said appealingly, "But why should you forget it? Why must it be a forbidden topic? What is the barrier? Are you no longer free? Speak, Miss Dows, give me some hope." "Miss Dows, Sally." She had drawn herself away, distressed, protesting, her fair head turned aside, until with a slight twist and narrowing of her hand she succeeded in slipping it from the glove, which she left a prisoner in his eager clasp. "There. You can keep the glove, Conal," she said, breathing quickly. "Sit down. This is not the place nor the weather for husking frolics. Well, you want to know why you mustn't speak to me in that way.
Be still, and I'll tell you. She smoothed down the folds of her frock, sitting sideways on the bank, one little foot touching the road. You mustn't speak that way to me, she went on slowly, because it's as much as your company's wo-th, as much as our property's wo-th, as much maybe as your life's wo-th. Don't lift your comb, Conal, if you don't care for that, others may. Sit still, I tell you. Well, yo come here from the no-th to run this property for money, that's square and fair business, that any fool here can understand, it's no-th and style, it don't interfere with these fools' family affairs, it don't bring into their blood any no-th and taint, it don't divide their clannishness, it don't separate father and son, sister and brother, and even if yo got a foothold here and settled down, they know they can always outvote yo 5-1. But let these same fools know that yo record an SOTHN girl known to be union during the war, that girl who has laughed at their foolishness, let them even think that he wants that girl to mix up the family and the race and the property for him, and there ain't a young or old fool that believes in SOTHN isolation as the price of SOTHN salvation that wouldn't rise against yo. There isn't one that wouldn't make shipwreck of yo our syndicate and yo our capital and the prosperity of Redlands for the next 4 years to come, and think they were doing right. They began to suspect yo from the first. They suspected yo when yo never went anywhere, but stuck close to the farm and me. That's why I wanted yo to show yourself among the girls, they wouldn't have minded yo flirting with them with the chance of yo breaking yo heart over Tave Reed or Lympy Morris. They're fools enough to believe that a snub or a jilt from a SOTHN girl would pay them back for a lost battle or a ruined plantation. For the first time Miss Sally saw Cortland's calm blood fly to his cheek and kindle in his eye. You surely do not expect me to tolerate this blind and insolent interference, he said, rising to his feet. She lifted her ungloved hand in deprecation. Sit still, Conal. Yo ve been a soldier, and yo know what duty is. Well, what's yo duty to yo company? It neither includes my private affairs nor regulates the beating of my heart. I will resign. And leave me and Aunt Miranda and the plantation. No. The company will find another superintendent to look after your aunt's affairs and carry out our plans. And you, Sally, you will let me find you a home and fortune north? There is work for me there, there is room for you among my people. She shook her head slowly with a sweet but superior smile. No, Conal. I didn't believe in the war, but the least I could do was to stand by my folks and share the punishment that I knew was coming from it. I despise this foolishness as much as yo, but I can't run away from it. Come, Conal, I won't ask yo to forget this, Mo, I'll even believe yo meant it, but yo'll promise me yo won't speak of it again as long as yo are with the company and Aunt Miranda and me. There mustn't be more, there mustn't even seem to be more between us. But then I may hope, he said, eagerly grasping her hand. I promise nothing, for yo must not even have that excuse for speaking of this again, either from anything I do or may seem to do. She stopped, released her hand, as her eyes were suddenly fixed on the distance. Then she said with a slight smile, but without the least embarrassment or impatience, there's Mr. Champney coming here now. I reckon he's looking to see if that wreath is safe. Cortland looked up quickly. He could see the straw hat of the young Englishman just above the myrtle bushes in a path intersecting the avenue. A faint shadow crossed his face. Let me know one thing more, he said hurriedly. I know I have no right to ask the question, but has Mr. Champney anything to do with your decision? She smiled brightly. Yo asked just now if yo could have the same chance he and Chet Brooks had. Well, poor Chet is dead, and Mr. Champney, well, wait and see. She lifted her voice and called, Mr. Champney. The young fellow came briskly towards them, his face betrayed a slight surprise, but no discomfiture, as he recognized her companion. Oh, Mr. Champney, said Miss Sally plaintively, I've lost my glove somewhere near Poa Brook's tomb in the hollow. Won't you go and fetch it, and come back here to take me home? The colonel has got to go and see his sick racial expletive s in the hospital. Champney lifted his hat, nodded genially to Cortland, and disappeared below the cypresses on the slope. "You mustn't be mad," she said, turning in explanation to her companion, "but we have been here too long already, and it's better that I should be seen coming home with him than you." "Then this sectional interference does not touch him," said Cortland bitterly. "No. He's an Englishman, his father was a known friend of the Confederacy, and bought their cotton bonds." She stopped, gazing into Cortland's face with a pretty vague impatience and a slight pouting of her lip. "Colonel. Miss Sally. Yo say yo had known me for 3 years before yo saw me. Well, we met once before we ever spoke to each other." Cortland looked in her laughing eyes with admiring wonder. "When?" he asked. "The first day yo came. Yo moved the ladder when I was on the cornice, and I walked all ever yo had. And, like a gentleman, yo never said a word about it. I reckon I stood on yo head for 5 minutes."
"Not as long as that," said Cortland laughing, "if I remember rightly."
"Yes," said Miss Sally with dancing eyes. "I, a SOTHN girl, actually set my foot on the head of an OTHN scum of a colonel."
"My.
Let that satisfy your friends then."
"No.
I want to apologize."
"Sit down, colonel."
"But, Miss Sally."
"Sit down, quick."
He did so, seating himself sideways on the bank. Miss Sally stood beside him.
"Take off your hat, sir."
He obeyed smilingly. Miss Sally suddenly slipped behind him. He felt the soft touch of her small hands on his shoulders, warm breath stirred the roots of his hair, and then the light pressure on his scalp of what seemed the lips of a child. He leaped to his feet, yet before he could turn completely round a difficulty the young lady had evidently calculated upon he was too late. The floating draperies of the artful and shameless Miss Sally were already disappearing among the tombs in the direction of the hollow. Chapter 5. The house occupied by the manager of the Drummond Syndicate in Redlands, the former residence of a local lawyer and justice of the peace, was not large, but had an imposing portico of wooden Doric columns, which extended to the roof and fronted the main street. The all-pervading creeper closely covered it, the sidewalk before it was shaded by a row of broad-leaved ailantus. The front room, with French windows opening on the portico, was used by Colonel Cortland as a general office. Beyond this, a sitting room and dining room overlooked the old-fashioned garden with its detached kitchen and inevitable Negro cabin. It was a close evening, there were dark clouds coming up in the direction of the turnpike road, but the leaves of the ailantus hung heavy and motionless in the hush of an impending storm. The sparks of lazily floating fireflies softly expanded and went out in the gloom of the black foliage, or in the dark recesses of the office, whose windows were widely open, and whose lights Cortland had extinguished when he brought his armchair to the portico for coolness. One of these sparks beyond the fence, although alternately glowing and paling, was still so persistent and stationary that Cortland leaned forward to watch it more closely, at which it disappeared, and a voice from the street said,
"Is that you, Cortland?"
"Yes.
Come in, won't you?"
The voice was Champney's, and the light was from his cigar. As he opened the gate and came slowly up the steps of the portico, the usual hesitation of his manner seemed to have increased. A long sigh trilled the limp leaves of the ailantus and as quickly subsided. A few heavy perpendicular raindrops crashed and spattered through the foliage like molten lead.
"You've just escaped the shower," said Cortland pleasantly. He had not seen Champney since they parted in the cemetery 6 weeks before.
"Yes, I thought I'd like to have a little talk with you, Cortland," said Champney. He hesitated a moment before the proffered chair, and then added, with a cautious glance towards the street, "Hadn't we better go inside?"
"As you like.
But you'll find it woefully hot. We're quite alone here, there's nobody in the house, and this shower will drive any loungers from the street." He was quite frank, although their relations to each other in regard to Miss Sally were still so undefined as to scarcely invite his confidence. Howbeit Champney took the proffered chair and the glass of julep which Cortland brought him. "You remember my speaking to you of Dumont," he said hesitatingly, "Miss Dow's French cousin, you know? Well, he's coming here, he's got property here, those three houses opposite the courthouse. From what I hear, he's come over with a lot of newfangled French ideas on the racial expletive question wrought about equality and fraternity, don't you know, and the highest education and highest offices for them. You know what the feeling is here already? You know what happened at the last election at Coolidgeville, how the whites wouldn't let the racial expletive S go to the polls and the jolly row that was kicked up over it? Well, it looks as if that sort of thing might happen here, don't you know, if Miss Dowes takes up these ideas. But I've reason to suppose, I mean," said Cortland, correcting himself with some deliberation, "that anyone who knows Miss Dow's opinions knows that these are not her views. Why should she take them up?" "Because she takes him up," returned Champney hurriedly, "and even if she didn't believe in them herself, she'd have to share the responsibility with him in the eyes of every unreconstructed rowdy like Tom Higby and the rest of them. They'd make short work of her racial expletive S all the same. But I don't see why she should be made responsible for the opinions of her cousin, nor do I exactly know what taking him up means," returned Cortland quietly. Champney moistened his dry lips with the julep and uttered a nervous laugh. "Suppose we say her husband, for that's what his coming back here means. Everybody knows that, you would, too, if you ever talked with her about anything but business." A bright flash of lightning that lit up the faces of the two men would have revealed Champney's flushed features and Cortland's lack of color had they been looking at each other. But they were not, and the long reverberating crash of thunder which followed prevented any audible reply from Cortland, and covered his agitation. For without fully accepting Champney's conclusions, he was cruelly shocked at the young man's utterance of them. He had scrupulously respected the wishes of Miss Sally and had faithfully, although never hopelessly, held back any expression of his own love since their conversation in the cemetery. But while his native truthfulness and sense of honor had overlooked the seeming insincerity of her attitude towards Champney, he had never justified his own tacit participation in it, and the concealment of his own pretensions before his possible rival. It was true that she had forbidden him to openly enter the lists with her admirers, but Champney's innocent assumption of his indifference to her and his consequent half-confidences added poignancy to his story. There seemed to be only one way to extricate himself, and that was by a quarrel. Whether he did or did not believe Champney's story, whether it was only the jealous exaggeration of a rival, or Miss Sally was actually deceiving them both, his position had become intolerable. "I must remind you, Champney," he said, with freezing deliberation, "that Miss Miranda Dowes and her niece now represent the Drummond Company equally with myself, and that you cannot expect me to listen to any reflections upon the way they choose to administer their part in its affairs, either now, or to come. Still less do I care to discuss the idle gossip which can affect only the private interests of these ladies, with which neither you nor I have any right to interfere." But the naivete of the young Englishman was as invincible as Miss Sally's own, and as fatal to Cortland's attitude. "Of course I haven't any right, you know," he said, calmly ignoring the severe preamble of his companion's speech, "but I say, hang it all, even if a fellow has no chance himself, he don't like to see a girl throw herself and her property away on a man like that." "One moment, Champney," said Cortland, under the infection of his guest's simplicity, abandoning his former superior attitude. "You say you have no chance. Do you want me to understand that you are regularly a suitor of Miss Dowse?" "Why, yes," said the young fellow, but with the hesitation of conscientiousness rather than evasion. "That is, you know I was. But don't you see, it couldn't be. It wouldn't do, you know. If those clannish neighbors of hers that southern set suspected that Miss Sally was courted by an Englishman, don't you know a poacher on their preserves, it would be all up with her position on the property and her influence over them. I don't mind telling you that's one reason why I left the company and took that other plantation. But even that didn't work, they had their suspicions excited already." "Did Miss Dowes give that as a reason for declining your suit?" asked Cortland slowly. "Yes. You know what a straightforward girl she is. She didn't come no rot about not expecting anything of the kind, or about being a sister to me, and all that, for, by Jove, she's always more like a fellow's sister, don't you know, than his girl. Of course, it was hard lines for me, but I suppose she was about right. He stopped, and then added with a kind of gentle persistency, "You think she was about right, don't you?" With what was passing in Cortland's mind, the question seemed so bitterly ironical that at first he leaned half angrily forward, in an unconscious attempt to catch the speaker's expression in the darkness. "I should hardly venture to give an opinion," he said, after a pause. "Miss Dow's relations with her neighbors are so very peculiar. And from what you tell me of her cousin, it would seem that her desire to placate them is not always to be depended upon. I'm not finding fault with her, you know," said Champney hastily. "I'm not such a beastly cat as that, I wouldn't have spoken of my affairs at all, but you asked, you know. I only thought, if she was going to get herself into trouble on account of that Frenchman, you might talk to her, she'd listen to you, because she'd know you only did it out of business reasons. And they're really business reasons, you know. I suppose you don't think much of my business capacity, Colonel, and you wouldn't go much on my judgment, especially now, but I've been here longer than you," and he lowered his voice slightly and dragged his chair nearer Cortland. "I don't like the looks of things here. There's some devilment plotting among those rascals. They're only awaiting an opportunity. A single flash would be enough to set them in a blaze, even if the fire wasn't lit and smoldering already like a spark in a bale of cotton. I'd cut the whole thing and clear out if I didn't think it would make it harder for Miss Dowse, who would be left alone." "You're a good fellow, Champney," said Cortland, laying his hand on the young man's shoulder with a sudden impulse, "and I forgive you for overlooking any concern that I might have. Indeed," he added, with an odd seriousness and a half sigh, "it's not strange that you should. But I must remind you that the Dowses are strictly the agents and tenants of the company I represent, and that their rights and property under that tenancy shall not be interfered with by others as long as I am here. I have no right, however," he added gravely, "to keep Miss Dowse from imperiling them by her social relations." Champney rose and shook hands with him awkwardly. "The shower seems to be holding up," he said, "and I'll toddle along before it starts afresh. Good night. I say, you didn't mind my coming to you this way, did you? By Jove! I thought you were a little standoffish at first. But you know what I meant." "Perfectly, and I thank you." They shook hands again. Champney stepped from the portico, and, reaching the gate, seemed to vanish as he had come, out of the darkness. The storm was not yet over, the air had again become close and suffocating. Cortland remained brooding in his chair. Whether he could accept Champney's news as true or not, he felt that he must end this suspense at once. A half-guilty consciousness that he was thinking more of it in reference to his own passion than his duty to the company did not render his meditations less unpleasant. Yet while he could not reconcile Miss Sally's confidences in the cemetery concerning the indifference of her people to Champney's attentions with what Champney had just told him of the reasons she had given him for declining them, I am afraid he was not shocked by her peculiar ethics. A lover seldom finds fault with his mistress for deceiving his rival, and is as little apt to consider the logical deduction that she could deceive him also, as Othello was to accept Brabantio's warning. The masculine sense of honor which might have resented the friendship of a man capable of such treachery did not hesitate to accept the love of a woman under the same conditions. Perhaps there was an implied compliment in thus allowing her to take the sole ethical responsibility, which few women would resist. In the midst of this gloomy abstraction, Cortland suddenly raised his head and listened. "Cato." "Yes, sir." There was a sound of heavy footsteps in the hall coming from the rear of the house, and presently a darker bulk appeared in the shadowed doorway. It was his principal overseer, a strong and superior Negro, selected by his fellow freedmen from among their number in accordance with Cortland's new regime. "Did you come here from the plantation or the town?"
"The town, sir."
"I think you had better keep out of the town in the evenings for the present, said Cortland in a tone of quiet but positive authority.
Are they going to bring back the old patter rollers, sah, asked the man with a slight sneer.
I don't know, returned Cortland calmly, ignoring his overseer's manner.
But if they did, you must comply with the local regulations unless they conflict with the federal laws, when you must appeal to the federal authorities.
I prefer you should avoid any trouble until you are sure.
I reckon they won't try any games on me, said the Negro with a short laugh.
Cortland looked at him intently.
I thought as much.
You're carrying arms, Cato.
Hand them over.
The overseer hesitated for a moment, and then unstrapped a revolver from his belt, and handed it to Cortland.
Now how many of you are in the habit of going round the town armed like this?
Only the men who've been insulted, sah.
And how have you been insulted?
Moss Tom Hi-E down in de market reckoned it was high time fancy racial expletive s was drove into de swamp, and I allowed that loafers and beggars had better roost high when working folks was around, and Moss Tom said he'd cut my hot out.
And do you think your carrying a revolver will prevent him and his friends performing that operation if you provoked them?
You said we was to protect ourselves, sah, returned the Negro gloomily.
What for then did you drill us to use dem rifles in de armory?
To defend yourselves together under orders if attacked, not to singly threaten with them in a street row.
Together, you would stand some chance against those men, separately they could eat you up, Cato.
I wouldn't trust too much to some of dem racial expletive s standing together, sah, said Gate darkly.
They'd run before de old masters if they didn't run to em.
Shuah.
A fear of this kind had crossed Cortland's mind before, but he made no present comment.
I found two of the armory rifles in the men's cabins yesterday, he resumed quietly.
See that it does not occur again.
They must not be taken from the armory except to defend it?
Yes, sah.
There was a moment of silence.
Then it was broken by a sudden gust that swept through the columns of the portico, stirring the vines.
The broad leaves of the ailantus began to rustle, an ominous pattering followed, the rain had recommenced.
And as Cortland rose and walked towards the open window, its blank panes and the interior of the office were suddenly illuminated by a gleam of returning lightning. He entered the office, bidding Cato follow, and lit the lamp above his desk.
The Negro remained standing gloomily but respectfully by the window.
Cato, do you know anything of Mr. Dumont, Miss Dow's cousin?
The Negro's white teeth suddenly flashed in the lamplight.
Yeah, ha.
I reckon, sah.
Then he's a great friend of your people.
I don't know about dad, sah.
But he's a powerful enemy of de Reeds and de Higbys.
On account of his views, of course.
Deed no, said Cato with an astounded air.
Jess on account of de Vendetta.
The Vendetta.
Yes, sah.
De old blood quoll of de families.
It's been going on over 50 years, sah.
De grandfader, fader, and brother of de Higbys was killed by de grandfader, fader, and brother of de Dumonts.
De Reeds chipped in when all de Higbys was played out, fo de was relations, but de was chawed up by some of de Dowses, first cousins to de Dumonts.
What?
Are the Dows in this vendetta?
No, sah.
No mo.
Day's been no man in de family since Miss Sally's fader died that's let de Dows out fo ever.
De loss shootin' was done by Moss Jack Dumont, who crippled Moss Tom Higby's brother Joe, and den skipped to Europe.
Day say he's come back, and is lying low over at Atlanta.
Dar'll be lively times if he comes here to see Miss Sally.
But he may have changed his ideas while living abroad, where this sort of thing is simple murder.
The Negro shook his head grimly.
Den he wouldn't come, sah.
No, sah.
He knows dad Tom Higby's bound to go fo him or leave de place, and Moss Jack wouldn't mind settling him too as well as his brother, for de scores is agin de Dumonts yet.
And Moss Jack ain't no slouch wid a scatter gun.
At any other time the imminence of this survival of a lawless barbarism of which he had heard so much would have impressed Cortland. Now he was only interested in it on account of the inconceivable position in which it left Miss Sally.
Had she anything to do with this baleful cousin's return, or was she only to be a helpless victim of it? A white, dazzling, and bewildering flash of lightning suddenly lit up the room, the porch, the dripping ailantus, and the flooded street beyond. It was followed presently by a crash of thunder, with what seemed to be a second fainter flash of lightning, or rather as if the first flash had suddenly ignited some inflammable substance. With the long reverberation of the thunder still shaking the house, Cortland slipped quickly out of the window and passed down to the gate. "Did it strike anything, sah?" said the startled negro, as Cortland returned. "Not that I can see," said his employer shortly. "Go inside, and call Zoe and her daughter from the cabin and bring them in the hall. Stay till I come. Go, I'll shut the windows myself. It must have struck somewhere, sah, shwell. Des a powerful smell of sulfur right here," said the negro as he left the room. Cortland thought so too, but it was a kind of sulfur that he had smelled before on the battlefield. For when the door was closed behind his overseer, he took the lamp to the opposite wall and examined it carefully. There was the distinct hole made by a bullet which had missed Cato's head at the open window by an inch.